All right. Hi, everyone. My name is Jennifer van Alstyne, and today I'm talking with Dr. Ruth C. White. Hi, Dr. White. Could you please introduce yourself?
Hi, I'm Dr. White, and I am a clinical associate professor in the Susan Dwork School of Social Work at the University of Southern California. I consider myself a mental health advocate, DEI consultant, and a bit of an adventurer.
I love it. Could you tell me a bit more about your role as a clinical associate professor?
So I teach graduate students, so MSW students. I teach them leadership, management, social policy, and I've been doing that for a very long time, probably more than 20 years. So USC is my latest position. I've been here for 7 years. Prior to that, I got tenure at Seattle U, and I taught at San Francisco State. And I've also taught, you know, courses at Berkeley and Fordham.
So all over.
And I've been teaching social work students since I was a graduate, since I was an MSW student in like 1991 at McGill. So that's my day job. And then out of that, you know, work as a professor comes my work as an advocate around mental health, et cetera.
Mm-hmm. That's amazing. And that's totally why I invited you on this show. So I'm excited that you joined us. You're also a diversity trainer, stress management expert, and mental health advocate, activist. Is that right?
Yes.
That's awesome. I read that about you on your website. Could you tell me a little bit more about that?
About the side stuff? You mean the mental
health? Yeah, I think a little bit more description about what kinds of work that is.
Yeah, so I started getting into diversity work as a intern. So I was a social work intern at a Black community center in Montreal when a young Black man got shot by the police. So that was 1988. And because I worked at the Black Community Center, at the time we were working with the police to improve police community relationships. And so I worked with the police on that, ended up actually going to a policing conference in Florida, like back in 1989 or so. And so that's got me into that. I also, my master's in social work, my thesis was to look at the disproportionality in terms of disposition in juvenile justice. So my master's internship was at a, I did probation and did court diversion programs. And so my study at the time was the first to actually quantify the disproportionality among comparing white youth to youth of color. And so that was, you know, that's the foundation of how I got into DEI work. And then my first grad student teaching position was teaching a multicultural social work class at McGill. From there, I taught a course in, I mean, now I would call it DEI, but I can't remember exactly what we called it then. But I did that for Seneca College, which is a two-year college in Toronto, in a social services technician program. When I was a grad student at Berkeley, I taught classes in race, ethnicity, and culture at San Francisco State for 3 years to both graduate and undergrads. And then I did the same at Seattle University. I taught race, ethnicity, culture, gender, those kinds of courses. So that's part of my diversity work. In terms of mental health advocacy, I found myself, I mean, I'm a social worker, so that, you know, was sort of par for the course as well, but I had a personal connection. So I have bipolar disorder, and just the way that I had to process that career-wise, so professionally, and learning a lot about the illness, I wrote my first book as part of that, which I'm not, as a social worker, I'm not the mental health side. I was more of a community person, and I ended up writing a book because I learned so much about brain function and how to manage mental health outside of just medications. And
that's
how I got my first book. That was my first book. And now I got, you know, 4 books later, I'm still writing about mental health, even though that was not exactly my training. Like I said, I am a social worker, so that is part of it. But it was my own personal experience that brought me to the advocacy side as well, because I realized that there was a lot of stigma, a lot of barriers to care, a lot of not understanding. So around how people experience symptoms, the cyclical nature of it, so that, you know, people are not always active in symptoms, whereas often they get treated that way. So, you know, if you say you have schizophrenia, people just think that you always are seeing things or you're always hearing things, and they don't really recognize that part of the illness. So that's, I think that kind of gets at most of it.
Yeah.
And this management work really grew out of my work with mental illness, because stress is such a trigger for mental health problems. And so as a public health person, I got focused on prevention. So I felt like, well, it's one thing to get treatment, but how do we prevent people from having mental health issues? And, you know, as I did my research, I realized the number one reason people go to their doctor is stress-related conditions, and how significant it is to our health if we learn to manage the stress in our lives.
Thank you so much for sharing that background, and also the personal side of what inspired you. I think that's so important for motivation, and also it sounds like the drive that brought you focus in each of those positions and moved you forward. Thanks for sharing that. So I reached out to you for this interview because a few months ago I saw a post that you shared on Instagram where you were talking about why you created your YouTube channel. You said that you wanted to get on TV, and so you started a YouTube channel, and you actually got to the Today Show from your very first video.
Yes.
Why did you, tell me more about starting that YouTube channel.
So I don't know. I was not a person that watched a lot of YouTube. So that's what, so to me, just kind of, I in my head, when I think back, I just remember I had, when I was first at Seattle, so right after graduating from Berkeley, I wanted to do a radio show. Mm-hmm. And there was the opportunity to do so at Seattle University.
Nice.
And so, which is very unusual. There weren't any other professors actually running a show. It was it's a student-led radio station.
Yeah.
And so I decided that I wanted to do a social policy show because I taught social policy, and I thought it would be great to be able to teach people about various social policies. And so I learned production, and I produced the show myself. I couldn't find a student to help me. So I produced the show myself, including, you know, getting guests, booking guests, writing the scripts, doing the ads, all of that, while I was trying to get tenure. So the show lasted about 6 months before, you know, I knew that it wasn't going to get a lot of value in terms of my professional career. Mm-hmm. And it was just taking out a lot of time. So
too
that just
time.
Kind of, right. So that just kind of sat there. And then I started to think about YouTube because I had something I wanted to say, and I just felt like recording it. And so it happened around the Me Too movement when what happened, literally what triggered me, was I was reading Facebook comments from a lot of my male friends, and all my male friends denied ever doing anything inappropriate with a woman, right? It was like, no,
ever?
I knew people who did it, but not me and not my friends. Like, I never grabbed a boob. I would never do that. I would never disrespect a woman. Now, I thought it was hilarious because I knew some of these men and they'd done it to me. So, you know, when I was younger, because that was the norm at the time. But just the fact that every woman I know was sharing a story. Like, literally, I had never met a woman that has said, I've never gotten harassed by a man, right? And yet, no man was claiming responsibility. So, for me, it was kind of like, there's this disconnect between everybody, all these women saying, this is what happened to me, and all these men going, not me, just this dude who's on TV or, you know, who's in the newspapers.
Yeah.
And so I just literally sat down and I just ranted. And my friends liked it, and they're like, oh my God, it's so you, because that's kind of how I am. Like, something, I just get a bug up my butt and I...
you have to get it out there. Yeah.
And I just had to get it out there. And I used to write all the time. So I had a Psychology Today blog And I actually had two other blogs because I like to write. So I had this, and that's the thing, it's like I usually have an opinion about things. And mm-hmm. so I had this blog that I had called Provoking Policy. And it was just, I would just spew on whatever policy I wanted to spew on. So that was a blog that I had on Blogspot for years. Like, I think I started it maybe 11, 12 years ago. And then I always say, like, people always say, why don't you continue? And my thing was, I said what I had to say. Like, I just didn't have that much more else I wanted to say. I commented on the things that, you know, were important to me. And so I had the Psychology Today blog as well. And I had written pieces around sexual behavior, even though it was a culture, the Psychology Today came to me and asked me to write a blog around culture and mental health. And I called it culture broadly defined. So I was writing about gender roles and the way mm-hmm. that, you know, sex as part of that. And so I did that video. And then as part of my Psychology Today blog, so I was doing freelance. I was just messing around on Upwork, which is a freelance platform, and somebody asked me to write a blog post for them around what was it called? Toxic masculinity in adolescent boys. And all they wanted me to do was just to put a live link to their resource. And I got paid to write that blog. Not a lot, I think it was $100.
Yeah.
So between those two things, the Today Show found me and they wanted me to comment on toxic masculinity among adolescents. So I got interviewed by Maria Shriver. I live in Oakland, so I teach online. I flew down to LA because it was on the USC campus. And it was an interesting process. You know, they screened me kind of wanting to know what my opinions and stuff were because I was kind of, you know, outspoken on this video. And then, yeah, I flew down to LA and Maria Shriver interviewed me and we recorded that. And, you know, the link is no longer live because, you know, they have so much shift in those.
Yeah, of course.
In terms of volume. But it taught me that it really didn't matter how many people saw my video, it was who saw my video. Because at the time that they reached out, I think 200 people had seen my video. You know, it didn't go viral, didn't have 100,000 people looking at it, didn't even have to this day, it doesn't have 1,000 people that saw it. I don't even think it has 500, maybe 500 people. And then the blog post, I don't know, 2,000 people at the time had seen it. So
yeah,
it was just one of these things where it taught me a lesson about the way I kept perceiving social media, which was that you needed a large following for it to have impact or for people to the right people to see it.
What's really remarkable about what you just said is that it sounds like they got in touch with you based on just two things, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Amazing. I mean, because I'm not a gender scholar. And in fact, it was kind of funny because Maria Shriver, because you have to prep for the interview. So before the actual recording, she just kind of figures out, you know, what she's going to ask and et cetera. And she asked me, she goes, so you're a gender scholar. And I was like, no, I'm not. You know, like, that's not what I do. I've never done research that's focused on gender. Like I said, I've written and I taught, but it's commentary that I was writing, right? Mm-hmm. And I taught gender in college, like as a, like race, gender in class in terms of a framework for analysis in US history. But it's not what I do. It's what I talk about. and so that was fascinating to me because I think her expectation was that I was, you know, a professor of women's studies or feminist studies or gender, whatever. And I wasn't. You know, I think I've taken one class that has to do with gender, and that was a economics of gender and family class that I took as a tenured professor. Like, I actually went to the grad class because it's always been an area of interest. So for me, that was a learning experience because I also recognized that our voices can reach into corners through social media in ways that traditionally it would have been hard to, right?
So absolutely.
Yeah. So without these sorts of outlets, I would have never you know, been considered for something like that, because that was not my area of, I think it's my area of expertise, but it was not the area I studied.
Right. You know? And not the area that is like most prominent on, say, exactly. your CV or your exactly. faculty profile.
Exactly.
So it sounds like just a Google search really was able to connect the right people with the right person, like to be an expert guest. That's mm-hmm. exactly the type of thing that I like to talk about in terms of social media, how connecting with a smaller but more focused audience can, mm-hmm. can be super beneficial. So mm-hmm. I was so excited that you decided to join me on this show. I'd like to talk more about your YouTube channel because okay. we talked about that first video, but tell me yes. more about your channel. It's called Rant Rave Reason. What kinds of yes, videos do you share?
Okay. So when I first started out, it was funny because my daughter thought I looked too professorial. She's like, nobody wants to see you talk, like read something
That's
off
so
of
funny.
A, you know, off of a, what do you call it, teleprompter, because I actually downloaded a teleprompter little app and everything. She's like, Mom, like, you know, she's in her young 20s. So for her, like, YouTube is what they watch. They consume a right. lot of YouTube, right? And she's like, Mom, people just sit on their sofa and have a conversation with people, and that resonates. And so in the beginning, you know, I actually had a few ideas about the name, and I went on Facebook and I said to my friends, which one of these do you like? And they all loved Rant Rave Reason because it was so, like, I wish I had captured that name before for my first book. Because I was like, that's kind of what I do, is I either rant or I rave about something, or I'm very much, like, people know me as somebody who will reason with anyone. Mm-hmm. Like, I do not unfriend people. I do not call people out. I just like to reason with people. Like, I like to figure out why people are thinking the way they do.
Me too.
what is their perspective? Mm. And I, you know, I think they're all valid perspectives. Now, do I agree with them? No. Do I think some of them are dangerous? Yes. But at the same time, it's my strategy is to reason with people. Because I also figure out that if you understand why people are thinking the way they do, it is much easier to change their mind than to just try and, you know, bang them over the head with the, you know, it's justice. But if you get at what is it that they're afraid of, what is it, like, what experience do they have in life that brought them there? So Rant Rave Reason, I basically do social commentary. So in the beginning, I had it as different episodes. And then I decided mm-hmm. tracking the episodes was just kind of like, I don't know, like sometimes I forgot to put the episode on. So I keep thinking I should go back to like episode 10 so people know what I talked about. But I've talked about things like immigration. Mm-hmm. I talked about Roe v. Wade. And so, you know, my background is maternal child health. I did a lot of reproductive health. I was a sexual health educator. I evaluated sexual health programs. So for me, Roe v. Wade has always been a very powerful issue. And also I found myself having this conversation with a lot of, you know, right-wing people all the time. And so I thought I would address it. I also, one of my episodes talks about diversity in politics and why it's important to have diverse points of view in politics, and not just for the optics, but for the different opinions that people bring in terms of political engagement and political perspectives. And so, yeah, so I talk about a wide range of things. Lately, I've been talking about race. I did do a little video on the admissions scandal. That one resonated with people a fair bit. I think part of it too is that I am at USC, and USC was part of, you know, the whole thing. But what got me motivated for the last four episodes. After that, I started doing stress management stuff because it, again, around COVID-19, stress became a huge factor. There was Kaiser Family Foundation had recorded the fact that people were feeling anxious and mm-hmm. They were having, that COVID-19 was really having a negative impact on people's mental health. And I thought I would address that. Being on TV, so we'll talk about that though in another, that's another line of questioning, I know. So then lately I've been talking about race. And so one of my videos went kind of my level viral, not everybody level viral, but about 3,800 people have seen it and about 2,000 people saw it in the first 48 hours. And it was basically me just spewing. I literally had come home from working out. I'd walked 5 miles, came home, and it was just like on my brain as I was walking. And I literally came in, didn't wash my face, didn't change my clothes, sat down in front of my phone, and I just spewed something. And the thing is, the 4 points that I talk about in the video, I had put on a little square, you know, those little sort of squares that you put on Instagram where you just put, you know, you just put a saying on Instagram. So it was just like a post on Instagram. And after I posted it, I was like, oh, you know, I have so much more to say about those four things. And so then I had the video about it. And yeah, and it resonated with people. And suddenly my YouTube channel went from like, I don't know, 60 subscribers to about 160, which then allowed me to like customize my YouTube name. And it just got kind of, I felt now that I owed people videos, you know, it's like, oh, okay, I've got subscribers. Well, they subscribe to something, so I should give them So that's, you know, so lately I've been talking about allyship specifically on that channel. I think I have another video that I want to talk to white men about. So for me, I don't really write a script, you know, I just like, this is how I did one video. I just have a couple
little notes.
Yeah, I literally have one index card, and then I sit down and I talk. I think for me, it has to resonate. Mm-hmm. So if the topic resonates, then I don't need a script, you know?
Yeah.
Have an opinion on it. And so I just sit in front of my camera, put some powder on and be like, okay.
I like that. And one of the things that I like most is that the video that really resonated most was the one in which you didn't really prepare. You hadn't washed your face. You just come in from a workout and you just sat down and hit record. And that's what got you all the subscribers and attention. And you said just 48 hours. So that's amazing, because I think that, at least for me, I know that I'm always kind of like uncomfortable being on camera and feel like I need to prepare, very much like you in the sense that teleprompter would be my initial go-to. But yeah, I think it's right.
I literally use, so sometimes, where's my little clips? I use, you know, those little
clips. Like binder clips?
The binder clips. Like I will sometimes, when I used to, like when I show up on TV or something, or to remind myself, I would take binder clips and clip index cards to my laptop.
Because then you can see them.
But then I can see them without going down. And because my daughter also said, she's like, people can tell you're reading, you know? So it's great having a 20-something-year-old to go, you know, to tell me about YouTube etiquette. but yeah, you know, and sometimes I'm like, I don't want to forget a particular minute. So, but I really feel what she was saying about scripting, because I think when it's scripted, you feel more constrained. Mm-hmm. And you... if you stumble over something, you feel like you got to go back and say it. Whereas the person that's watching you, they really don't know what else you had to say. So you don't have to feel like, oh, I messed up my lines. Let me start over. Which was what I was doing a lot of, where it was like, I'm taking me 3 and 4 and 5 times to record a video. And I realized it really didn't change much. And so sometimes in the beginning, like I'll start and then I say, oh, I don't like that start. But once I'm like 2 minutes in, I'm usually good. I'm like, fine, I'm just going to post it anyway.
Do you edit it? Or you just send it?
But I so suck at editing. So it took me, I did one video where I was trying to I think I have 2 videos on my YouTube channel where I was experimenting with editing. And it just took me so many hours.
Wasn't worth it.
4 words on. But I think, you know, like my daughter keeps saying to me, mom, if you practice, it gets really easy. She's like, you know, adding a title. Yeah, she's like, adding a title will just be so easy. But because she did them in high school, they had a lot of assignments that had them doing iMovie and stuff. And so I'm definitely thinking about doing more of it, because I think even though my videos are only 5 or 6 minutes long, I think sometimes they could have a bit more punch visually in terms of grabbing attention, because, you know, at the end of the day, social media is about the media part of it.
Right.
People do want to see something that grabs their attention. And if it grabs their attention, they're more likely to click on it and listen to it.
That's great. And just for everyone who's listening, the nice thing about this conversation is that it didn't really matter in the beginning whether there was editing, whether there was scripting or not. That very first video got her on the Today Show. So there's always room for improvement, but you can just start. That's really great. Thanks for sharing that with me. Let's see. So we did talk about the Today Show a little bit more, but I'd love to talk more about how you got your other TV bookings, because when you were posting, you said that you were getting up early in the morning to be on the news as a mental health expert. So how did those come about?
Again, I'm one of these women. I'm just like, I throw things against the wall and see what sticks, right? So like literally that's how my friends are like, why did you? I'm like, I don't know. It was 2 o'clock in the morning. It was an idea. And literally that's what happened. It was 3 o'clock in the morning. It was like the Sunday before spring break. And so I had, you know, I knew I had the week off and I was just kind of messing around. And I was reading something about stress during COVID-19, and I was like, I've written about stress, and I had a book coming out in May. So I'd already written the book. I think I'd got it done like late January. And so this was like early March, and I sent an email to, I was trying to find the contact information for TV stations, and it's really hard to find them, like really hard. You start going down rabbit holes, you're clicking on things, it says contact us, you get there, there may be a form, there may not be. Anyway, so I was looking for local San Francisco channels, like the main ones, like the ABC, CBS, etc. And then I was on one called Cron 4, and it said, you know, they had an active link that just said, you know, if you have a story, contact us. And so I used that link and I said, I would like to be on to talk about stress. I had maybe 5 or 6 sentences of a bio and the link to my webpage and LinkedIn page. Go to sleep, wake up at like 10 o'clock in the morning because it's spring break, and realize I'd missed an opportunity to be on TV that morning. So they got my email at 3 a.m. and somewhere around 8:30, they had emailed me to go, we'd like to have you on today. So then I was like, my sister said, see, you know, early bird catches the worm, right? She's like, if you would just get up early, because I'm sleeping. I stay up late and sleep in all the time. So she was like, this is how you miss, you know, opportunities. So then I emailed them right away and I said, I can be on tomorrow. And they said, okay. So I get all done up, whatever, for tomorrow. And Trump had a news conference, like the first COVID-19 news conference. And so they postponed it. The other interesting thing to note is that I had had a ring light for weeks. My daughter had said, you need a ring light. I mean, she has a ring light on her phone, you know, like she's an adolescent. She was a young adult. So I'd never used this ring light. It had been sitting under my desk. And the Sunday before, like that same day when I reached out to them, I had put it together and tried to figure out how it worked. Mm-hmm. And 3 days later, I needed a ring light to be on TV, right? So that was like the Tuesday, and then they planned to put me on the Wednesday. And I got on, and what was embarrassing in a way was so it was their morning TV show. Mm-hmm. And the host literally called me out on TV, and she goes, you actually emailed us and say, I want to be on TV. And I said to her, yeah, and here I am. Okay, you calling me out, but it worked because I'm sitting here talking to you. And so at the end of the Skype call, the segment, she says, oh, it'd be so great to have you on. We should have you on all the time. And I was like, I'd be on all the time if you want me to. And that was it. Click Skype, hang up. My landline rings and I pick it up and I say hello, because nobody ever rings my landline. And they said, oh, you hung up too early. Would you like to be on tomorrow? And I said, I sure would. And so I came on the next day. Same thing. I hang up after Skype. The phone rings and they said, we'd like to have you on indefinitely.
Amazing.
So they were like, you know, we'll reach out. And so the first, like 4 weeks, I was on probably a couple times a week. So since early March, I've been on there around 12 times.
Amazing.
As a mental health commentator. And then their evening news person decided they wanted to have me on the evening news. So, and then that led to other things, because like CBS LA reached out and asked me to be on there. And it's just funny around technology as well, because my Skype wasn't really working for some reason on my laptop. And so I recorded my CBS LA one on FaceTime. Like, when I told my friends, they were like, you can get FaceTime with that kind of quality. I mean, it looks studio quality.
That's great.
They were like, just use FaceTime. It works for us. And so again, that's what I was, you know, saying about how social media has changed things, because now we can do that. Like, I can be in Oakland and be on my phone and be on TV, you know?
That's amazing. And
that's not how it was 10 years ago.
So in terms of equipment, you had a ring light, and is that it?
I have a ring light and my MacBook Air might be 3 or 4 years old, and an iPhone 11.
And you used the built-in camera for your AirBook and for your camera?
Yeah. And I don't even use, like, so one time, my first time on, I had, you know, the earphones with the cord.
Yeah.
And my friends saw it when I posted it. My friend was like, you cannot be on with that.
On television.
And so, yeah. And so it was so funny. They sent me like a gift of earbuds. They were like, you know, here's to your TV success. I did buy a microphone. I don't want to necessarily.
A lavalier mic?
Yeah, like this thing.
Yeah.
But I still haven't used it yet, because nobody has told me that the quality was bad. So like, even for TV, they were like, oh, it's fine. And I mean, they're very picky about sound.
That's amazing.
And they were like, no, it's fine. So I was like, okay, well, I'm not going to mess with it then, since it works.
Yeah, I agree. You know? And if you're fine, then, I'm fine.
Yes. And I've done Facebook Lives without the, you know, the microphone. I did a segment for the Commonwealth Club. I did a panel yesterday with the Commonwealth Club of California, and I didn't use a microphone, and they were fine. So I'm like, okay, as long as it's quiet in the background, you know?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
That's great. Thank you so much for sharing that, especially about the equipment. That's such a good tip to know.
Yeah. So, you know, I also, cause I Googled like equipment for on air, and they, and a lot of places just said, start with, you know, the basic stuff, especially if you're not separating sound from visuals.
Right.
But they were like, if you want to do like a podcast that, you know, where the sound, you need the better quality sound, then you need the better.
Because it's audio only, right?
Because it's audio only, right. And so that's why I bought it, but I still haven't, I don't even know how it works really. So I'll have to see how it works. But yeah, I just think that I had so many barriers in my head about what it would mean to do this in terms of setup and recording and all of that, and realizing that I had what I needed, you know.
That's great.
So, yeah.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing that. Okay. So my next question is, it's kind of personal. I'm always uncomfortable on camera. This is one of my first times where I'm doing a full recording for the interviews on camera. Okay. I have another interview scheduled next week, but it's always a little anxiety provoking for me. So you seem very comfortable on camera. Do you have any tips? Like, how do you get comfortable before you're going to shoot?
Yeah, I think it takes practice. So part of it is, you know, being a professor, you're in front of an audience all the time.
Right.
I tell people, you know, being a professor is show business. Like, you know, if you're not putting on a show, people are falling asleep. And because I used to fall asleep with professors who just taught me the information. Like, you have to, you know, especially in some of the boring topics that I teach one in research, which students come in and they're like, oh God, I don't want to do this. So my job, I always feel, is to make it engaging, to make the metaphors I use, you know, more that resonate. So we're not just talking, you know, it's like, oh, okay, if we're thinking about efficacy and effectiveness, let's talk about a condom, right? And then people will, like, I'll actually tell my students, do you remember the story I used? And they'll be like, oh yeah, I remember the concept. And so, and then I've done modeling. So that's something that I do on the side, which is kind of also weird because not a lot of professors model. And so that kind of also got me sort of comfortable in front of the camera. I mean, I think being in front of the camera as a model is very, like, you feel very self-conscious because you're trying to portray something and you're very aware of, you know, your body and your face and did you do it right? I think my first concern around being on camera was makeup. And I felt like I don't even know what makeup looks like for bright lights. Like I'd been once or twice on TV, and then the kind of makeup they put on was not necessarily my forte. And so that was kind of self-conscious. And so like after my first two TV appearances, I fixed that. Like I just looked at it and I went, okay, that's kind of bright. you need more like browns. And it was funny because I brought this brown eyeshadow once and I was like, why did I buy brown eyeshadow? I'm brown. Like it's not going to show. And then I realized that it did.
But for the light, it makes a big difference.
Exactly. It makes a big difference. And then also I Googled what to wear on TV. And I'm glad that I did. Because my wardrobe is not TV friendly. Like,
do you have a lot of patterns?
I have a lot of black and white graphics. I have a lot of black, a lot of white, and prints, you know? And so then I was like, oh crap, what am I gonna wear on TV? So the first couple of times I had this one top, and then my sister goes, so are all your clips gonna have the same top in them? And I went, oh, okay. Let's go see what else I have. And so some of them I actually wore a dress just because I wanted the top part to be different.
Of course. Nobody's seen me in a dress.
Yeah. So even though nobody's seen me in a dress, I was like, well, we just get a dress. And then I, you know, I added jewelry. And then I read this thing about, you know, jewelry shouldn't be distracting. And so it was, I had to do some work to now figure out sort of what I want to look like on screen.
That's great. Thanks for sharing that. And I think also one of the things it sounds like is that whereas you had the equipment that you were concerned about or anxious about maybe needing, you already had all that stuff, but then you found that there were other things that helped you feel more comfortable. And part of it was learning the makeup and changing that up. And part of it was practice. So thanks. Yeah, definitely. That's helpful.
And I think also feeling as if you're prepared. So one of the things that started happening with the TV people, and it happened a couple of times, and then I said, you guys can't do this to me. I got called a couple of times, literally with 45 minutes. And I mean, to wake me up, like I'm asleep, the phone rings, it's 7:30 in the morning. And
we need you on in,
in 45 minutes. And I was just kind of like, okay, I can, you know, and I'm just jumping up. And then I remember this one segment where they started showing a video of people in Florida on the beach. And I remember going, what are they going to ask me? Like, I had no idea what they were showing the video for. And then they asked me about young adults, you know, why they want to rebel and go on spring break, et cetera. And yes, I could answer that because I'm a social worker and I worked with adolescents for a long time. But I asked them to give me advance notice because I was like, if I know what I'm going to talk about, I can seem more informed. I can actually educate the audience. I can, you know, have some data like, oh, look, you know, the Mayo Clinic found this or Harvard found that. I won't have that off the top of my head if you just sit me down and here comes whatever the anchor wants to talk about now. So I think also preparing is part of making me feel comfortable. So like you shared questions with me and that allows me to kind of know, oh, okay, I know what I'm going to be talking about. So that really makes a difference.
Now, when you realized that was something that you needed time to prepare, can I ask how did you go about asking for that or communicating that need to the studio?
That's actually a good question. So I just emailed them and I said, you know, first of all, I wanted to know if you get paid. I don't know anything about media. So I had a friend who was a journalist. So I'm like, do they pay you for this? And he's like, generally, no, but they will like promote a product. And I was like, oh, my book. So I had them promote. I sent them a graphic of the cover page and they said they would do that. And they said they would send me advance notice. Sometimes that advance notice was just email. I also then started pitching them stories. So once I was on and I would, so I remember, you know, the whole work from home thing started getting crazy and I've been working from home for 7 years. So I pitched them and I sent them an email and go, I would love to talk about working from home. And they were like, great idea. I said, I'd like to talk about parenting because my sister and I did a YouTube video around stress for parents because my sister's a parenting educator. And I was like, we should do a YouTube video. That one's actually longer than most of my YouTube videos. So that's about 12 minutes long. And so, yeah, I started pitching them ideas and sometimes they would take me up on it, and sometimes they wouldn't. But I just, my dad always said, you know, open mouths get fed. So I just open my mouth. Because they, you know, what are they going to say? If they say no, it's fine, you know?
Yeah, it doesn't take them any time to respond to, it sounds like probably a couple sentences of a pitch. Yeah. Like, it's not very long.
No.
So, yeah, you're helping them think of ideas or giving them ideas. Yes. that they can just say, well, we don't need that right now. And that, yes, makes it easy for them.
Exactly. You just nailed it. So my friend was a journalist actually on that station, and he had retired years before. And he said to me all the time, he goes, Ruth, journalists are always looking for stories. So if someone brings you a story, that's just one less story you have to look for. And right. I think that was a really important message for me, because at first I just thought, okay, they'll find me. But it's you offering them something. And then I did the same with Fast Company and getting an article. I had this thing where for 2020, I said I wanted to be on TV doing commentary, and I wanted to be in a business magazine. And so same thing. I went looking for Business Week or Forbes, could not find their email. I found the email for Fast Company, sent something to the editor. I didn't hear, they said like 5 to 7 days. I didn't hear back. I emailed them and I said, you know, if you don't want it, just let me know so I can put it somewhere else. And the editor was like, oh my gosh, we actually, this is perfect timing. We'll run it on Friday.
Wow, and that's great.
Yeah. And so they ran it. And then I came back to her the same way. And I went, okay, they did it once. Let's see if they'll do it again. And so I still have a pitch right now with them. I just don't have time right now. But yeah. I got 3 pieces in related to COVID in Fast Company. So I think what's important is for people to offer themselves as a resource, you know, and it might take a few hits. But again, like I say, journalists are looking for stories, and we can help them with their job.
The other tip that I think that you shared is to keep it shorter. When you said that you initially reached out to the mm-hmm. local TV station in San Francisco, that was just a short bio and links to your LinkedIn and what else?
Yes, and my website.
Your website.
Yeah, and I think for those things, what people don't realize, especially with LinkedIn, is that you can put clips of your work on LinkedIn. And a lot of people don't know that. And my friends are like, wait, you have video on your LinkedIn. And so, you know, I even put the order of the videos so that they can see my work, so that when people find me on LinkedIn, they can see me on TV on LinkedIn.
That's
because I
great.
Think that's important, because they want to know what you look like and they want to know what you sound like on TV before they put you on.
That's great to know. And I like that also. It sounds like that your LinkedIn and your website, it spoke for itself. Like, you didn't necessarily need to go out and pitch yourself as this amazing expert, because those profiles that you had were already speaking for itself. And so they
yes.
were able to just visit and make that decision.
Yes. And, you know, it was funny. I have a friend who had a YouTube channel teaching people how to code. And she was the first person that told me I needed video on my website. And I said, what am I going to do? And she says, just put an introduction. I said, I never see websites like that. And she's like, that's my point. And I went,
yeah.
Oh, because she's like, that will just stand out. And literally on my website, I think I have like an intro that's like, hey, my name is Ruth Wright. Welcome to my website. But I thought it was corny. And she just said, you know, it just gives you a clue to who the person is rather than just seeing
right.
a picture. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a totally, it's more dynamic than just a headshot, which is what I have on my website right now. But I'm going to be changing that, especially after talking
yes.
to you.
Yes.
It sounds like just that personality can make a huge difference with how likely people are to reach out and actually connect
yes.
with you when you, especially when you've reached out to them first. So that's great.
Yes. Yes, I definitely think, I mean, and my website is something I do. It's old. I need to upgrade it, but I just haven't gotten around to pay somebody to do it. And every time I think about paying somebody, I'm like, oh my gosh, now I have to sit down with them and they have to understand my design ideas. But
yeah.
my website is really old, but it serves its purpose.
It seems very clean. Like, I understood a lot about you when I was able to visit your website and all of the pages. Like, it's very clean. It's understandable. And that makes a
yes.
huge difference.
And I think what happens is that I say to somebody, do people really hire you because you have a flashy website? You know, like in the work that I do, right?
Oh,
like,
right.
Is somebody going to bring me on TV because, oh my goodness, her website was amazing. Like, no.
Well, they brought you on TV from your vlog where you were sitting
exactly.
in front of a camera and being yourself.
Exactly. And so I have friends who, you know, they're like, oh, it's going to cost me $2,000 for a website. I'm like, your website, unless you're actually like a creator of some kind and people want to see your creativity, people want to find out who you are, what you do, and what other people think about you. And if you can just do that as a basic, then yeah, I mean, I have friends who are like, Ruth, you need to upgrade it. And I do, but at the same time, I don't think that's what's driving, like, flashy graphics is not what's making people find me.
No, your work is what's making people find you. Right. The articles and the videos that you're putting out is making people find you, and the right people.
Yes, the right people. Because it's true, like, I have friends with really nice websites and they do stuff, but they're always like, people come to me literally and go, you know, who's your PR person? I'm like, I don't have one. And they're like, right. How do you get on TV? I'm like, literally, this is how I get on TV. And I think, you know, that more people need to understand the dynamics of it. I started realizing that journalists are kind of lazy, you know, like they have, you know, but they need
they're very busy.
They're very busy, right? And it's when I say lazy, it's like, they don't want to have to spend 2 hours digging to find the expert, right?
Yeah.
And they used to use journal articles. Now, like, I have asked, like, how do you find me? Because I was very fascinated. First time BBC World Service called, I thought it was a friend joking, right? Like, I was like, okay. And they said, we would like to have you on our show called The Y Factor. And I said, okay, about what? And she said, about race. Now, that made me almost laugh inside, because I was thinking, there are so many race scholars in the United States who have written amazing best-selling books. Why do they want me as their featured expert? And she said to me, you wrote this blog post called The Race Card, and it really connected with us. And I went, wait, I wrote a blog post on my Psychology Today blog, and that's getting me on BBC World Service. What? And I was just like, my sister goes, what? I was like, I asked. I was like, she told me that's how she found me, you know?
I love that you asked.
I asked because I was so, like, at first I thought, like, what? You know, because, yeah, I write about race. But again, I'm not writing books about race. I don't do research about race. I've taught the subject. But they just liked my angle. And so I wasn't even just one comment. They had me for the whole show. I recorded it on my iPhone 7 at the time or whatever. And I think it's really, I want to encourage people to not be intimidated by that whole media process, because that's been my experience, is that it's not as complicated as people think it is. And the thing about hiring a PR person is you got to pay them regardless of whether or not they get you on.
That's okay? Very true.
So you have to pay them a retainer, they do their work, and you still might not get on, but you paid them. And getting on media helps you get on more media, but it sometimes is not a direct link to income. It's an indirect link to income, right? So being on TV doesn't bring you money right away. It just helps build your brand.
Absolutely. Because as you said, and you asked them, like, yeah, you weren't sure if you were going to get paid for those TV show spots.
Right.
You had to ask your friends and ask the network whether that was something that they even did.
Yeah, I didn't know. Right. And I think I also was intimidated to ask in kind of a way. And my friend
I would be too.
Like, yeah. And my friend was just like, ask them. And I was like, yeah, that makes sense. Just ask them. Like, if I say, do I get paid? Are they going to say, no, we don't want you on TV anymore? And it was right. He was like, they'll just tell you yes or no.
That's great.
I'm like, yeah, that's true.
All right. So my last question is, for new faculty or graduate students who are thinking about getting into YouTube, starting recording some videos, what advice do you have to share with them?
I say, find what you're passionate about. Because then the conversation that you're having comes off more natural, because it's just you talking like you're talking to your friend. And that's what I do. I'm looking at the camera, and I always say it's like me at brunch spewing with my friends, you know, with my little opinionated self. And I think if you're passionate about that, that comes across and it makes people want to keep listening, right? Because people have short attention spans. I was reading something from YouTube itself, you know, from the YouTube creator channel or whatever. And they said something like, after 4 minutes, people start dropping off, right? And I was like, what? Like 4 minutes? And
so that's short.
It's so short. And that's why I did the 5 to 6 minute thing. Because then I thought, well, after I'm done saying what I'm saying, I can talk about subscribe to my channel or whatever, but they will get the message. And that's the other thing to note, that it doesn't have to be an hour, that a lot of people are not going to, it doesn't matter how amazing they are. And that's why TED Talks are, you know, there are some TED Talks that are 12 minutes. And yeah, these are amazing speakers who have practiced and they're on a stage. And but TED knows that after about 20 minutes, we're gone. Bye-bye. Mm-hmm. You know, so to also take that into consideration, that think about how long you sit and watch something and whether or not somebody else would do that, especially if you don't have a guest. So like you and I are in conversation. If yeah, I'm having a conversation, it's much different than me just sitting talking to a camera.
That makes a lot of sense. And it's probably also, it would be harder to sustain like a 20 minute video when what you're going off of is notes. Like maybe you could get used to that. I'm sure podcasters do, but on video, that feels more challenging.
Yeah. And I also just felt like, I also felt that in academia, we say way too much sometimes. Like we just get, you know, like I had friends who always said, how do you write a 500 word op-ed? And I went, because you just say what you got to say and be done with it, you know? And they're like, yeah, I just can't edit it. I used to edit so many of my friends' pieces because they were like, I just can't get it down below 1200 words. I'm like, nobody goes through the New York Times letter to the editor or the editorial page to read your thesis, you know, like, no. And also to make the words accessible. Like, I'm not gonna sit here and talk about, you know, the intersectionality of the, you know, whatever trans, that, blah, blah, blah. You know, like the only people that would listen to that are people who study that, you know? So mm-hmm. It's also important, I think, for academics to remember to make things accessible, because the more people that can understand what you're saying, the more people that will actually listen to what you're saying.
Great. That was such a good tip. I feel like being yourself is, it sounds like really a huge drive in terms of how you appear on video, how you appear on TV spots, and how you feel comfortable also when you're talking and what you're talking about. It's all about what you're interested in and what you can bring to the table and what you can share with people. And I love that.
Yeah. And I think that's what's really important, like you say, is to bring yourself. You know, if this is not how you would talk normally, you are going to look awkward, right? And that's what my daughter noticed. She's like, you look awkward. You look nervous. She's like, you talk to people all the time. And I do, I talk to strangers. So she's like, you talk to strangers. You just randomly talk to people. Do that, you know, just do that. And it will resonate with people. And I think that's really important, to not try and like, oh, I want to be like this person, or I want to be like that person. Like be the person that you are.
Great. Thank you so much. Is there anything that you'd like to add? You're welcome to let us know about your book or anything else.
Yes. Coming up. So I do have 2 books. Well, this is the latest one, which is Everyday Stress Relief. And then the one that's really popular is the Stress Management Workbook, which a lot of people find useful. It just basically walks you through developing your own stress management techniques, etc. I think that's it. And again, oh, right, my YouTube channel is Rant Rave Reason. You can find it on there, Ruth C. White. If you just Google, if you go into YouTube and look for Ruth C. White, you'll find it there. And I think that's it. And I have a Psychology Today blog called Culture in Mind. You can also find me on Medium, because I took my Provoking Policy blog to Medium because my friend was like, Blogspot is not as popular as Medium. So I'm now, you can find me, Ruth C. White, on Medium. And again, I write about social commentary, etc.
Awesome. I'll be sure.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, this was so much fun. I'm going to include all the links to your books and to your channels, definitely in the blog post and below the video.
Thank you.
This was such a good conversation. I so appreciate all of your expert advice and telling all of those stories about how you got on television and starting your YouTube channel. This is great.
Thank you so much.
All right.